the empty pews. This is what Sunday after Easter, and it's also the AGM, looks like. Always! However, if you, I'm getting a lot of echo, Jennifer. Thank you for working whatever magic you can. A lot of people don't want to come to the AGM. I was just saying to Jennifer a moment ago, the only time people come to an AGM is if something bad and contentious is happening. So this is actually a really good sign. If you are staying for the AGM after the meeting, we'll be happy to see you then. And Julia and Billy are here for the kids during the service. So we're going to start this morning with gathering songs on a theme of light. Does anyone know why I've chosen the theme of light this Sunday? Yes. Hello, Ian, yes. Tomorrow's the eclipse. Thank you, Ian. Ian gets 10 points in the beautiful frigid air freezer. Okay, let's stand up and let's sing about light. Thank you, Nancy.
Fantastic! And Anthony, we're going to need this at a bit of a clip.
super easy if you've never done it. I say that, like, may the light of God be in you. You say, and also with you. Turn to the people who are traveling with you in this spiritual hour today and say hi. So here we go. May the light of God be with you. Turn around and say hi to people on your left and your right. And you guys can be seated. So, last Sunday was Easter Sunday. We have a tradition here. Thank you to everyone who baked the cupcakes and brought them in undecorated. Look what our kids did for our meal program. Absolutely fantastic. You should see it when our meal program guests come and they get to this at the end of the buffet. There's these incredibly imaginative, creative, brightly colored cupcakes. It is an absolute beloved tradition down there and up here. So thanks to the kids and Billy Jane for being here. The annual general meeting is after church today. We're going to have sandwiches and squares here, coffee at the back. We're going to invite people to bring up chairs, and it'll just take us a few minutes to get sorted. This service today will be shorter than usual. Remind me after I said that. It will be shorter than usual. So that we're not here a lot of extra time, and your council has planned a very efficient kind of meeting for you. So it'll be super interesting. If you want to know anything more about what goes on here, this is the best way to do it. Starting to next week. So sometimes I do a series of a number of weeks. I'm going to do that for 4 or 5 weeks. We're going to have 1 week of interruption for Earth Day. But we're going to be doing 4 or 5 weeks about building your spiritual toolbox. What does that mean? That means that, you know, when times are good, we go along, we just kind of don't think too much about how we're getting through the day. But then when something happens, or when we're carrying a problem, a trouble, a concern, or the world is starting to tell us that it's not a good place to be, anything like that, you want to have spiritual tools. You want to be able to say, okay, now I need to bring this into my life. Now I need to use this. Now I need to be here. I'm going to take 5 super simple ones. We're going to build on them week by week, and that's what we're going to do starting next week. It will be located in Scripture, but really it's taking the precepts of Scripture and saying, when the bad time comes or difficult times come, here's what we want to do. Here's our toolbox, okay? Starting next week. Music with Anthony. So we're going to do 2 things at once right now because we're doing a shorter service. Julia is here. I assume Billy's in the back room. Billy? I saw her. Okay, so small ones want to go out with Julia. Julia's right there. So the small ones, with or without parents, are going to go out with Julia. Older kids are going to go find Billy. And you're going to do that as Anthony plays for us. Thank you, Anthony. We're still on the theme, right? Thank you.
But first, I have a light and dark joke. Okay. So God is walking through heaven, looking pretty pleased with him, her, their self, and comes across an angel. And the angel says, "God, you look so happy. Like, what's going on here, right? You look particularly like thrilled with yourself." And God said, "Well, you know what I did? I just spent some time making light and making darkness and then separating the two." And the angel said, "Wow, that's amazing. No wonder you're looking so excited. So what are you going to do with the rest of your time?" And God said, "I don't know. I thought I'd call it a day." A toughest audience. Seriously, toughest audience. Okay, who's eclipsing tomorrow? Apparently this is a verb now. You guys are eclipsing? What are you guys doing? You're going to Soaring Park and you got the glasses. Okay, what are you doing? You're going to Hamilton. Are you leaving like now? Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Anybody else? What are you doing? That's right. William will be working in our office. Thank you, William. So William is walking over to the library lawn. Anybody else eclipsing? What you doing, Alex? The Air Force Base. Oh, yeah, like Downsview, kind of? Cool. Okay. Liz and I were driving to St. Catharines yesterday, and you know they have the big signs on the highway that say, "Slow down, icy conditions," which they ran, by the way, all winter. Like, all winter we're driving and it's 8 degrees and sunny. "Slow down, icy conditions." Anyway, yesterday they all said, "Expect extra traffic for the eclipse," and then they had the date. And on the Weather Network, they have a countdown to the eclipse. So it's like, in case you guys don't know, it doesn't happen very often. See, good you got me to tell you that. And it's a super big deal, right? In fact, eclipses have been a super big deal throughout history. And understandably, people have looked for different ways to explain them. I was looking at a number this week, and the one that I was most intrigued by was there was one culture in ancient times that believed that during the eclipse, a large black squirrel was eating the sun. Which, you know, if you've seen the Hyde Park squirrels, that seems possible to me. I Google, right? Who's made a picture of large black squirrel, angry squirrel, like mean enough, like big enough to eat the sun? And this is all I could find. Cute little squirrel going, "Oh, I'm going to take a little nibble of this sun cookie," right? I mean, I was quite disappointed. There are also lots and lots of cultures where the sun is very closely associated with God, even still. So, for instance, in Hinduism, there were ancient stories about this moment being a moment when the sun god was actually being killed or dying or being destroyed. Needless to say, this would be extremely upsetting and alarming, and there were rituals to be said for it. In Islam, there is still a special prayer to be said during the eclipse. When an eclipse apparently occurred during the time of Muhammad, it happened to occur on the day that his eldest son died. And people came to Muhammad and said, "Surely, surely this is the heavens grieving for the loss of your son." And Muhammad, God, his name be blessed, said, no. This is part of the wonders of the working of the universe, and we must say a special prayer of thanks and awe for this. Most of the stories, if not all of them, of ancient times that I could find, thought the eclipse was a super bad thing. Super bad thing. And you can understand why. The sun being the source of life, right? It's not good when it goes away, when it's supposed to be out. So people would rattle sticks, or they would get bones and throw bones at the sky, trying to chase away the evil spirits that were taking their sun, their life away. In the Bible, it's very arguable. Some scholars say that there are 34 references to eclipse in the Bible. I think that is really pushing it myself. You see what I spend my day doing? Reading these things, going, "I don't know." Okay, but there's a couple that I just thought I would share with you just so you could hear the kind of things that you hear in the Bible. And these ones tend to be in anticipation, okay? If you don't do this, or if this other bad group, who are our enemies, do this. This is what's going to happen. So we've got, for the stars of the heavens and their constellations will not give their light. The sun will be dark and the moon will not shed its light. And we've also got another one I picked out was, when I blot you out, I will cover the heavens and make the stars dark. I will cover the sun with a cloud and the moon shall not give its light. Those are both pretty scary. Yeah. As I say, most of the older accounts, the ancient accounts that I found, were interpreted the eclipse as an act which engendered fear. And that's what I want to talk about today. Albert Einstein said, when you can no longer pause in wonder and awe, then you may as well be dead. You have closed your eyes. Okay? He said, if you're not able to let the wonder of the world enter you, fill you, pull you up short, as an eclipse does, right? An eclipse is a moment when nature is so impossible to ignore. We're pulled up short. We have to watch. He says, you may as well be dead at that point if you can't see that wonder. It's like you're living with your eyes closed. Now, when I say that the eclipse was interpreted as fear and fear in the Bible, I think it's really good to remember that fear, the word fear in the Bible, is not a really useful translation. Okay? When someone translates from another source, and all of our Bibles are translated from another source, even if you go back to the Koine Greek or the ancient biblical Hebrew, we don't know a lot of those words. So the translator will have an idea of what it might say. They'll think, okay, the theology is this, so we want to go in this direction. If it's a translator working now, they might go back to a Bible that was translated 100 years ago, 200 years ago, okay, and say, okay, they use this and they use this, so let's go with that. Certain things we become sacrosanct, right? We think of Mary as a virgin, right? That word don't mean virgin. The word in the Bible means a young girl. Didn't necessarily mean a virgin, but that is such a sacrosanct idea now that most translators will use virgin. So they also have possibly a list of things that this could be. Okay? I'm going to translate this, and I'm coming to this word, and this word in this case is fear, or this word has been translated traditionally as fear. I'm going to translate it as fear. And you understand that, because the idea of fear is something that pulls you up short, right? Makes you pay attention, stops you in your tracks, just like the eclipse did for ancient people. But that word fear could just as properly be translated as awe or wonder. In fact, in the ancient scriptures, there's that word, same word is sometimes used in a place where what the original writer was trying to say is this is the time of astonishing joy. Okay? Joy, wonder, and awe. So I've often said to people, any Bible verse you come through in across in English, if it says fear, try wonder, try awe. Okay? We're going to be in awe of what God is doing here. We're going to be in awe of what God is making happen in the world. Okay? However you understand God to be, of course. So the idea that we need to be afraid often overtakes this idea that in fact what we're being called to do, what is most healthy and useful for us, is to be, as Einstein said, in a state of wonder, in a state of awe, in a state of, oh my gosh. And not just in these big, wow, I'm pulled up short in my tracks moments, but in every moment. Alex Trebek, long way away from Einstein, I know, said, anyone who is not filled with awe every time they step outside the door is just an idiot. And we get what he means. It is so easy to need an event that pulls us up short before we will stop and really look at our lives. And the same is true for the wonders that surround us. We can walk through High Park, and I'm going to look at Tim now because he's going to be nodding in a minute. We can walk through High Park because we want to walk, because we're letting our troubles sit on our mind, because we're judging the people who go by us who don't have their dogs on a leash, whatever it is, okay? Or we could use that as moments, even one moment, to be present to the awe, to the wonder that is everywhere around us. People who are Christian, Jewish, Islamic, Wiccan, Druid, New Age, scientists, they all talk about that same thing, don't they? They all talk about the thing that is grander than ourselves, more than our little bodies and our little minds, the thing that fills us with wonder. There is not a scientist whose biography I've ever read, and I read a lot of biographies, who has ever located what they do, what drives them in anything other than wonder. Even if their job or their mission is to cure cancer or polio or whatever the disease is, they always say, I am constantly pulled forward, they say, by a sense of wonder in how the human body works, in how what the human mind can do, in so many mysteries and miracles that occur all the time. There is a very famous teaching by the Buddha. The Buddha was sitting with a group of several hundred of his devotees. And of course, what was the Buddha here to do? The Buddha was here as Jesus to share enlightenment, right? To wake people up, to help them open their eyes to who they are and how mysterious and wondrous the world is and how connected they are to that. Jesus's job, Buddha's job. So the Buddha is sitting there and one of the Buddha's acolytes says, Master, Master, you know, I've been studying for years. I am very discouraged. Please, please, please just tell me, how do I find enlightenment? And the Buddha held up a chrysanthemum and just sat there in silence. I remember the first time I read that, I thought two things. First of all, I thought, wow, that's so beautiful. And then I thought, what the heck? Like, what? What is that? What is that? Like, is that just, you know, you get super wise, you're sick of teaching people, right? I told you all this stuff before, you're not getting it. That does sound like Jesus in the Bible, right? I'm just going to sit here with the chrysanthemum and see what you make of that. But honestly, the more I have learned about Buddhism and any other religion, I have realized that the gateway to feeling a sense of connection, the gateway to feeling a sense of groundedness and centeredness, the gateway to feeling a sense of energy, hope, optimism in our lives is wonder. It's wonder. It's not knowing all the answers. It's not letting the world press on us with its opinions about everything. It's the ability to do what Einstein said, to be able to pause and let awe in how extraordinary and perfect this world works, to remind us that there are wonderful things going on here that we are part of and that we can be open to knowing more about, open to knowing more about, always open to knowing more about. That was the message that the Buddha was giving. Pause. Reflect on how miraculous this chrysanthemum is. Just be there. Just be there. And suddenly the door to wonder and enlightenment opens for us. I remember years ago reading a book by Wayne Dyer. Anybody Wayne Dyer fans? Yeah, Wayne Dyer. Which I don't think we read much anymore. Anyway, that's okay. Wayne lived on. And Wayne had this theory that we have made everything about spirituality too complicated. And then he wrote about 32 books about it. but his idea was the same as Buddha. It doesn't have to be complicated. Waking up to who we are and our mission in the world and the love that we are and the, you know, the amazingness that we are a part of every day, which is sometimes crushed in all the ills we see happening and what we tell ourselves about ourselves. It doesn't have to be difficult. Wayne Dyer said, take 5 minutes a day. Go outside. Look at a cloud. Look at the sky. Look at a flower. Look at the snow. Look at a person walking down the street and think about how beautifully their muscles are working together to do that. Look at anything in the world outside you. Stay open to the miracle that that is. He said, take 5 minutes of spiritual care time a day, and the door of wonder will stay open for you and allow you to see yourself, your connection, and this world and the divine in a completely different way. So I am well aware that this is a very bad sermon title for the eclipse on Monday. Because if you don't have the glasses, close your eyes. But I think the eclipse is an excellent time to remember that we don't have to have something big happen in our lives to stop and pause. If you're walking at night, you can take a moment longer and look at the moon. If you're walking during the day, you can take a moment anywhere now in this neighborhood and look at the spread of blue violets or those first daffodils coming up in sunny places. Soon the tulips will be out, and then the lilacs and the hyacinths. Every spring I have two plans. One is to smell lilacs, one is to smell hyacinths. When you do those things, take an extra moment. That's all that's being asked for your spiritual path, for your spiritual growth and sustenance. Take an extra moment. And you'll find, as you're able to allow that moment of wonder to occur, that all of a sudden, you do feel that sense of connection in a different way. You do feel nurtured and healed and given to. And you do feel that if you've not achieved complete enlightenment, at least you can begin to walk the world knowing who you are, knowing that the divine is working in perfect order when we work with it. Knowing that this is still an extraordinarily beautiful world. All we have to do is open our eyes.
God, Creator, Guide, however we may know you, hear our prayer. Tomorrow, day will turn into night for a few moments. We will observe the nature experience with wonder and amazement. May we take time to give thanks for our planet Earth and to ponder our place in the cosmos. We pray for a truce in the Middle East, hostages returned, and humanitarian aid delivered to Gaza to save lives and to allow recovery to begin. We pray for an end to hostilities in Ukraine. We pray for lasting peace in the world. We give thanks for this church and this congregation. We have worshiped here for another year, finding comfort, strength, and direction in your word. Inspire us to continue to serve the community beyond our walls. We ask for blessings and healing for Dave, Jada Marie, Matt, Bettina, and Tamara. We pray these prayers in Jesus' name. Amen.
Rest and abide upon us everywhere.